Robert, when can we expect a more free approach to air travel?
That's a great question. And of course, in our industry, we hope that would have been yesterday or a couple of months ago. This is a real problem because it's really inhibiting free flow of passengers and choice to travel internationally. We expect, based upon some recent talk, that we could see a change, especially on testing. The PCR test requirement for Canadians to come back into this country is, as I mentioned, is a problem. And there has been increasing discussion at a federal level to either do away with the testing requirement altogether or to do as the Americans can do. You can enter by air either with a PCR test or with a much easier, much cheaper rapid antigen test. So we expect to hear something before Christmas.
Let's talk about vaccine passports. So you talked a little bit about the PCR and I guess how countries all need to get on board. We know that the EU has introduced digital certificates. Does this now need to come from Ottawa in the form of some kind of a proof of vaccination? What needs to happen?
We need to have a federal standard for proof of vaccination. All the provinces and territories are doing their own thing. There has been talk from Ottawa. They are working towards this goal. But of course, it makes it a challenge when you're traveling internationally and people haven't seen our standard before. I show up with a province of Ontario proof of vaccination and a QR code. It might be different elsewhere. So to really improve the free flow of passengers around the world to destinations they can indeed go to, depending upon the country, their entry requirements, their COVID situation. But we desperately need to have harmonized standards. I know that in addition to the EU, as you mentioned, the International Air Transport Association, IATA, which is the the largest airline association in the world, about 280 airlines belong to that, including Air Canada and Air Transat. And we have been working with IATA, and IATA has been doing a lot of great work to try and get these standards harmonized. So working with all of the individual countries and also the blocks like the EU. But again, Canada has got to simply move faster.
IATA recently coming out with numbers with respect to what travel looks like at this point. We are headed into that winter season. What do advanced bookings look like?
Yeah, we like to say in Canada, we're a very seasonally oriented aviation country where we have the big peak in the summer, a bit of a peak around Christmas, a peak around March break, and then other parts of the year, particularly the fall and early winter, can be quite slow. Now, overall, I mean, I have to start off by saying this past summer was very encouraging for domestic travel. Folks who didn't want to, you know, travel internationally or they couldn't travel internationally were embracing Canadian domestic tourism, and that was a great sign. I also know that a lot of Canadians want to get out of their homes that were used to going someplace warm. They want to do that this winter. And also as far as going further afield, for example, to Europe next summer. So at this stage, the advanced bookings look generally positive. I'm quite optimistic. If you were to speak with the heads of network planning or pricing with Canada's major air carriers, you would hear something relatively similar.
Robert, you had mentioned some of Canada's carriers. Let's just dive a little deeper into that to take a look at what's happening right now. Air Canada, of course, reported some steep revenue declines during the pandemic. Porter had suspended flights for about 18 months. Air Transat had no commercial flights. Tell us about, and of course, WestJet is in there as well. Tell us about what is happening here at home.
I think Air Canada's numbers for the third quarter that just reported were quite optimistic, quite favorable, positive direction they're going in. Certainly a vastly different picture this third quarter compared to year 2020, same quarter. Hard to say for, you know, the private carriers of this country, Porter being one, WestJet, of course, owned by Onyx Corporation being another one. I know, you know, WestJet has actually done quite well. They, of course, declined federal government aid, but they've been moving very, very carefully, but also relatively rapidly to restore capacity that was pulled down. So capacity, I mean, seats and routes that was pulled down in the depths of the pandemic. I think that WestJet's in fairly strong financial shape. And the question for me is Transat, which is, to your point, they had a lot of periods during the pandemic. They were not flying at all. Last year, May or June, and this past year, between January and April, they were essentially grounded when the federal government requested carriers not to fly to sun destinations. I think on the heels of the merger and acquisition with Air Canada being no longer being off the table, I believe Transat continues to look for some sort of partner, investment partner, to take it forward. They've got a lot of smart people they brought in recently. I think Transat knows, even before the pandemic, they had a number of years where the results were somewhat substandard, and Transat understands they have to remake the type of carrier they are. So they've got some people they brought in, for example, formerly from Air France, very, very strong in network planning and strategic alliances. And I think we're going to see some interesting news out of Transat in the coming half year or so. That said, I think, again, to your earlier statement, we're going into the darker, quieter months of the fall and early winter. I think Transat's got to be very, very focused and careful on their next steps.
Lastly, let's talk about permanent shifts in airline travel. What are you watching when it comes to leisure and business?
Well, for sure, you know, leisure was quite strong this summer. Visiting friends and relatives is recovering, although, you know, case in point, you know, I call them lower price markets like India or Vietnam, very, very price sensitive, price elastic markets. And the cost of the PCR testing family of four, an extra $1,000 coming back into the country and potentially the destination you're going to, additional testing requirements as well too. So that has really been affecting the, we call the VFR, visiting friends and relatives market. The business market is the one that I'm watching very, very closely, in that any company I talk to, from large multinationals to banks to IBMs, of course, all their staff were supposed to get back to the office in September of this year, pushing further out to like January or beyond. But I think the effect of virtual conferencing, the Zooms and Teams and WebExes, will have a lasting impact, especially with regards to intra-company travel. So if you work for a multinational in Toronto, you've got a big office in Montreal, I think the amount of that travel is going to decline fairly significantly. I am quite bullish, though, on the prospects of long-haul premium cabin travel. I know myself, there's certainly some types of business and clients you cannot get the business done by doing it via Zoom or Teams call. But back to the short-haul travel that we're watching, I think that's part of what's behind the move by Porter Airlines to expand its base beyond Billy Bishop Toronto City Airport, establishing a base with jets, regional jets, at the Toronto Pearson Airport, and flying to destinations across Canada and the US that they've never serviced before. And I think part of that move, in addition to just trying to get some growth going again for Porter, because they really have been restricted as to how many landing and takeoff spots they have at the Island Airport. But I think there has to be some concern as to the impact on Porter's bread and butter market. Short haul business travel in the Northeast US and Eastern Canada has been their mainstay. And if there's some concern about that recovery, I think it's actually a great time to go into the Pearson Airport and focus on their value-added product. But it's going to stimulate a lot of competition. WestJet and Air Canada are not going to take their foray into Pearson Airport, Toronto, lightly.